minister, that he's a living guy. But in law, these lawyers, they're so tricky. They've made it so these guys aren't responsible for what they're doing out there, because in reality, according to the law books, they're dead. They don't have any ability to save the living. They can only communicate to the dead. So this kind of explains why we got all these all capital names on our licenses. Because as corporations being dead bodies can't communicate to the living. They can only communicate to the dead. So when they capitalize your name, being that that's a corporation, it's dead. If you respond to it and jump up and say, well, yeah, I'm connected to that because you accepted it when you were younger and didn't know any better, well, they assume, good, we got another sucker. Another dead guy that's going to come and join up with us. Now, where I'm going with all this and why I wanted to bring in that dead corporate part of it is some people understand, some people don't. Some people think they understand, but they don't really know why they're doing it, and I still haven't got there. Why are they so insistent on making us dead? Why do they want us to have these all capital names? That's what comes back to the Bible. The Bible told the Hebrews, the Israelites, that if they, in their travelings, that if they should come across anybody, that they're supposed to expose them to God's love. They're supposed to love their brother, show them the way how to get along, and everybody's going to be happy. Now, God told them, if you come across these people and they won't follow God's law, they refuse, well, you're supposed to enslave them, treat them like cattle, and destroy them. This is the Hebrew nation that they're told to do this. God had good reason for doing that, because there's only one God, and if there's other people out there not following his law and worshiping other gods, that means they're bringing up their children to worship other gods, and their children, and their children. Things are getting out of control, so God, knowing this can't happen, it's going to create darkness on the world, and there's going to be much pain and anguish for everybody, said, no, we got to snuff those people. You got to stop that false god worship. It's not going to work. It's going to bring anxiety and pain and destruction. It's going to be men ruling men, and that won't work for you. You're not going to be too happy. So he put this law there, and he told the Hebrews, if the people won't follow it, enslave them. Now we got to wonder, most of us now, we're wondering why we're paying taxes. Why we got all these codes, rules, and regulations. Every month or so, there's another law in the books that you've got to learn, and if you don't know it, ignorance of the law is no excuse. All of those laws that man has been passing for I don't know how many thousands of years only apply to you if you're one of the dead, if you're a corpse. Those men that were, and women that were part of the Hebrew nation at that time, that were told, if you won't obey God's law, enslave them, destroy them, treat them like cattle, they're still here today. They're still following God's dictate. They're still worshiping God the way they believe in God, out of the first five books of this very Bible. They know God the same way you know God. The only difference is, they believe that if you're not following God's laws to the dictate of this book, and you've had the opportunity to, and you've been exposed to it, and you refuse, well, now you're cattle. But they give you a final opportunity to ensure that they're being fair with you and giving you the opportunity to take up God's law. Whenever you get in trouble, you get invited to come down to their courts. This is an offer they're making you. They're making you an offer to bow down to a false god. And they've even advertised it on their websites. Adrienne Clarkson says clearly on her website that she's the factor. Now, some of you here have already seen what that means, but to go along in this discussion to get it right, you have to know what de facto means. De facto means illegitimate, it means unlawful, it means usurped authority, it means like in a revolution. It's been taken over without lawful de jure authority. De jure means lawful. It's the opposite of de facto. So when Adrian Clarkson says she's de facto on her website, and I believe he's got a picture of it here that you can see, and I think it's got an asterisk. Nobody can see it with the camera, but I'm going to pass this around for those of you who haven't seen it. And for those of you who have, that's good. Have another look. Impress it upon your minds that when she's telling you she's de facto, she's got a disclaimer on her website to prevent her from being brought into any liability. We'll just wait for the phone. She's got a disclaimer on her website to prevent her from being liable to you or anybody else by intimidating people to bow down to these laws, codes, and rules and regulations of a false god government. Now, I don't know who tipped Adrian off, whether it was herself or her husband, John Ralston, whatever his name is there. He's quite a scholar. But that word, on my part at least, required a little investigation. So I went to law dictionaries and I looked it up. Sure enough, the definition in law dictionaries for de facto is unlawful, illegitimate, usurped authority. So then I thought, well, hold it now. Canada's got a creditor. Canada's in debt $750 billion. So I thought, well, that creditor might have something on its website in relationship to this de facto thing here. So I went to the World Bank's website, I typed into Google, my search engine that most people have access to with a computer. I put de facto in there, I think the word de facto, the word government, and World Bank. And up it came. There it was. Dealing with de facto governments, World Bank Operational Policy Manual. Number one, there was the word de facto, and a definition. And there it is, and it says, usurped authority, abrogated constitution.
Coup d'etat.
As in a coup d'etat, yeah. Which is a military occupation, a revolution, and...
occupation was
yeah,
in there, wasn't it?
Yeah, revolution and...
War occupation.
Anyways, it amounts to unlawful. Yeah. They don't use that word unlawful there, but the law dictionaries do. Yeah. But when you see that the word usurped is in there, well, you go look up the word usurped, for those that you don't know what it means, it means somebody that takes over a throne without lawful authority. So we ask ourselves, well, how is it that Adrian Clarkson doesn't have lawful authority? I thought she was appointed by the Queen. And that's where we all thought, but we were all wrong. Back in 1931, a history class here, the King was put in an uncomfortable position. He had a knock on the palace door, and I'm just going to figuratively speak this. And there's the bankers on the other side of the door, the world bankers, and they're holding the mortgages for all the countries and the Commonwealth countries. And they said, we brought these guys into debt since 1913, now they're bankrupt, and you're in charge of it all, so we're here to collect. My, those are nice jewels you have. The King goes, whoa, just a minute, closes the door, goes to his lawyers over at Westminster Abbey with the clerics and that, sits down, and they draft up the Statute of Westminster. The Statute of Westminster tells all the Commonwealth countries they're cut loose, none of the laws of Great Britain apply to them anymore. Why did the King do such a drastic measure? Because all of the Commonwealth countries under his domain had committed themselves to usury, which is the charging of interest, brought themselves into debt and a point of bankruptcy where they were losing all of their valuable bank gold. All of their gold was being taken out of their vaults because anything that they had was valuable was part of the deal with the bank. If you don't pay us back, we get to, it's just like anything else, the bank comes and takes what what you own. In the case of Canada, it was all of the gold in our vaults. So the king, with this 1931 Doctrine of Westminster, cut himself free from responsibility so the bankers couldn't get the jewels. He said, you're on your own, but I'm leaving you one thing. My royal style. Don't mess with my royal style. Now, I'm paraphrasing here, but in the preamble to the Statute of Westminster, that's exactly what the king says. He's leaving behind his royal style and title. Most people don't even know what that is. The royal style is defender of the faith. There's the Bible left behind in the courtrooms. And he's tossed us the Bible and said, this is what you got left. So now I'm coming back to those guys that were wandering through the desert when God said, enslave them, destroy them if they won't follow God's law. It turns out that the queen and the royal family and the bloodline of the queen go back to the house of Judah. Hebrew. Okay? She's in charge of this law. They didn't particularly, the scribes and the Pharisees, Hebrew, didn't particularly like what Jesus was doing because they had a monetary thing happening back then. Another set of religious codes and rules called the Talmud. It's still here today. It covers all of commercial transactions in the world. But moreover, it was designed for a law for the Goyim. The Goyim are those that are not Jewish. They don't follow God's law. They're the cattle. You have to have a law for the cattle. There's a law for God's people, the Bible, the Old Testament, all the commandments. And then there's a law for the people that don't know God's law and refuse to follow it. They need to be enslaved. So there need to be sets of codes, rules, and regulations for them. That's what the Talmud deals with. When you go into court, that's all commercial law. That's all Talmud. But we get a choice. Because we go in there, there's God's law sitting beside the judge. If you don't ask for it, demand it, stand up for it, it's assumed that you're standing for this. Man's law. Charter of Rights and Freedoms, British North American Act, Criminal Code, Municipal Government Act, you name it. Anything they've ever passed is part of that commercial law, Talmud. Anything God ever passed is right here. In his 11th commandment, Deuteronomy 4 and 2, he tells everybody, and the queen defends every word in this book, tells everybody, don't add to my law. Don't take away from my law. This I command you. That's a commandment.
You mean there's no section 91 and 92 in the Bible?
No, can't find it. None of this stuff is in there. Now, a lot of people like to say, well, what about Romans 13? We're supposed to obey the authorities. We're supposed to submit. You say, well, go read Romans 13. What does it tell you there? Well, it says all authority is of God. And I say, well, that's right. It says, for they are ministers of God to do thee good. I say, well, that's right. And it says that we're supposed to submit ourselves to them, okay, because they're of God. I say, well, that sounds pretty good to me. Let's check out those guys that they're saying they're ministers of God. Let's find out, because we know there's corruption. We know there was a guy named Nebuchadnezzar, told three guys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, to bow down to the fire god Molech. And they said, no way. That's not one of God's laws. That's one of man's laws. I can't obey you because God said I'm not supposed to bow down to false gods. So they wouldn't bow. They knew their law. They weren't going to bow. They got thrown in the furnace, but for their faith, they got protected. They weren't even singed. They exercised their faith. It's symbolic of what took place there, that how powerful it is if you exercise your faith, even the furnace isn't going to burn you. So when we go into those courts, and we got this offer, basically Talmud, and we have this offer, the Bible, we got to go into this Bible and say, hold it a second here. Why am I in these courts in the first place? Jesus told me not to be here. He said, settle with them first. It's so simple, too. Once you understand what he tells you to do, he says, settle with them. Before they bring you before the magistrates and commit to prison. Agree with them, he says. Well, the way you agree with them is you tell them about your faith and beliefs. You tell them Adrian Clarkson admits she's a false god. You tell them their creditor admits that that's what it means. You tell them that the Bible says, first commandment, I can't bow down to false gods. You tell them the queen's been brought into notice. You tell them the treasury board's been made aware and they agree. And you tell them, I need to know where you get the authority to intimidate me to violate my faith and beliefs. Now, if you don't tell them that, they get to assume that you don't have any faith and beliefs and you're following Talmud. Commercial law. You're in it for the money. You're not following God. Because you didn't stand up and say, is there anybody here that knows that I violated one of God's law that cares to bring forth testimony? You didn't tell them that before you got there, that you had faith in God's law, and you're going to have to ask that judge, magistrate, or whoever else, that I need some honor here. I've heard there's corruption in the government. And I can't submit myself to that corruption. Otherwise, I'd be violating God's first commandment. So I need you to tell me, in honor, if you know the meaning of your oath of allegiance. If you can tell me that, I know you're an honorable man or woman, and we can deal in honor. If you can't tell me the meaning of your oath of allegiance, as I'm empowered and of duty to ask, well, then I know that you're an imposter. You must have lied when you took your oath. Because anybody that says they'll provide true allegiance to a Christian monarch sworn as defender of the faith, and then not know what they swore an oath to, must have lied or is incompetent. You can't be competent after taking an oath and then not know what it means. Somebody says, I'll be truly allegiant, and you ask, what's that true allegiance mean? And they go, I don't know. They lied. They just promised and swore they'd be truly allegiant, and then they don't know. So if they lied, they're an imposter. If they're an imposter, they're incompetent. In 1988, the Supreme Court of Canada, none of its decisions apply to you, by the way. It's all Talmud, okay? None of those decisions apply to creations of God, those who believe in God's law. It only applies to Talmud. But anyways, in 1988, this guy said, I got a bad deal. This lawyer was incompetent, and he went through and lost the case, and I lost all this stuff. I want remedy. I didn't have a competent lawyer. He fought it all the way to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said, you're right. If the lawyer's not competent, then you get to redo all over again, but you first have got to prove he's not competent. Okay? That was a very important decision, because what it meant was not only the lawyers must be competent, but the prosecutor and the judge. They almost have to be competent as well. You can't say one for the lawyer, who's an officer of the court, and not have the other officers of the court not require competency levels as well. So my test of competency as a minister of God and defender of the King James Bible in the name of Jesus Christ is to ensure that who I deal with are not imposters, not incompetent, not some fellow that does not value an oath to God. I can't deal with those guys. I can only deal with somebody that's honorable, will defend God's laws as the Queen stands for. And they can't intimidate anybody to do otherwise once you let them know. Now, you're not going to go over there and beat them over the head with it. You're going to tell them lovingly that you don't want them to be offended. You don't want them to assume anything about you other than the fact you believe in God's word. You want to practice your faith and beliefs, you don't want to hurt anybody, you want to spread the word of love, and you want them to show you how they get the authority to intimidate you to violate your faith by bowing to them. You prove to them they're a false god with Adrian Clarkson, that does it. Next, if they don't believe that their charter doesn't apply to them, you can show them their own government's website. Heritage Canada has it right up on their website, section 32. From this so-called Talmud law, says right there that it only applies to the federal and provincial government. It doesn't apply to you if you're not government. And they even put in there, it says the purpose of this section is to make it clear, that the charter only applies to governments and not to private individuals, businesses, or other organizations. Now, the only reason that that's up on the website is because I insisted. I phoned them up. I said, you're Heritage Canada. Justice Canada wouldn't put it up on their website. They sent me to you. This is part of Canadian heritage, that you tell the truth to people that this charter does not apply to them. You better go to legal on this and check it out, because they'll tell you I'm right. They did go to legal, they did check it out, and there it is. Proof positive that that charter, Talmud, does not apply to you unless you submit. If they're telling you it doesn't apply, why would you be there? If the supreme law, the one up here, covering all the subordinate laws, that's the supreme law, they've just said it doesn't apply to you. Do the subordinate laws apply to you? Mm-hmm. How is that possible? It's impossible. Unless you submit. If you act like a slave, they will assume you're a slave. If you act like a master and show them the master's rule, and that if you're anybody's slave, it's slave of God, slave for Jesus Christ, an ambassador in chains, but you're not their slave. That's very important to make that differentiation between them. And as Christ told us, agree with an adversary quickly. He told us before that in Matthew 18:15-20, that we are to go to them privately. That's the biggest, most important factor in everything I tell people. The biggest, most important factor, which disarms them and puts them out of the protection of the government's justice system and their lawyers, is if you communicate to them privately.
So
to
that
the
be
private
with,
man, Paul Martin.
That'll be with that good faith notice that That's we've been right. using. That's what you're referring to.
All
single page, all 40 of them.
Yeah. That's it. Yeah, Stewart sent out 40 of them to the private man. However many names you put on there, the better. Don Carter back in Quesnel there, he put it out to 70. And I imagine by the time Stewart's done here, he'll surpass him. He'll break his record. And it's not like saying everybody's going to go and put $400 or $500 into registered mail. As a matter of fact, we're working on a process right now where you won't have to spend anything for registered mail. We've got a guy in Ontario that's got a system set up where you send it to him, and he'll post it up on the website, and he'll deliver notices, because he lives right near Ottawa, to all of these guys, so with the, where the website is, where this notice is to them, and it affects service upon them.
Mm-hmm.
Once you affect notice that they're being notified of a private matter, and you effectively serve that upon them, you don't give them the whole nine yards. He said he'll do that too, but he said he wants to make it so that people around the world can have a central place to notify
to people. Focus on.
Yeah, one central place, doesn't matter where you are. So you're not everybody spending thousands of dollars on registered mail. Let's save some money.
What's been happening in Australia?
Australia,
any
the people
idea?
Down there are real zealots. I think they're actually way ahead of the Americans. The Australian court system is actually ahead of the Americans in removing all of the people's freedoms. They have eliminated the jury altogether, thanks largely to the efforts of a real freedom fighter down there. Unfortunately, he didn't realize that every time he goes to court and loses, he makes them stronger. This is very similar to David Lindsay here in Canada, a very zealous, informed, phenomenally courageous freedom fighter that goes into courts, and he's better than most of the lawyers at knowing this stuff. Trouble is, he's so good, he brings the evidence that just knocks him down in the dirt. And because if they let him win once, it knocks down the whole system. So every time Dave shows up, it's a sure lose. Absolutely, a sure lose. He's there, you know he's going to lose, because they can't let any of it at his evidence win. Because it's so good. But on the other side of the fence, the judges are saying, hey Dave, do you realize every time you lose a case using this particular argument, nobody can ever use it again? Thanks a lot, Dave, but we just thought we'd let you know that we were wondering, do you know what you're doing? Because every time he goes in, and like I say, I have nothing but praise for the guy's courage, his tenacity. You should see him. He's a bulldog at court. They're afraid of him. They banned him from the court. But now they said, well, stop banning him, let him in, we'll make them lose every time, it'll make our Revenue Canada boys impenetrable, because every little nick and gnash that's ever been invented to get out from under tax, Dave brings it into court. And they lose. And they lose. And Revenue Canada gets stronger and stronger. But moreover than that, all these people that believe in this commercial Talmudian method of going in and fighting them with their law. Oh, we got a white knight now. He's going to win. When that white knight falls down, they say, that's it. You can't fight him. I give up. And they go back and they start paying. And anybody else they ever hear fighting, they tell them the whole story, how they went through it for years. And they saw it, and that's it. You can't win. The very best guy we had went down in court. We lost it. Now everybody's going to give in. You have total submission. Now another thing that's taken place throughout history, and many people know it, especially military people know it, is that if you have an enemy, and they're very large and powerful, and you want to bring them down, but there's only a few of you, okay? Like there's definitely more people in the country than there is tax employees or federal treasury employees. And they know, well, hey, there's a threat out there. A lot of people don't like paying taxes. That's been going on for a long time. People have been squirming them for hundreds of years. They don't like taxes. And there's people trying to figure out ways how to get out of paying taxes. Some of these ways are pretty good. These guys are getting good. If we're going to get run out of the town, like the tax guys, we're going to get run out of town, let's get ahead of the crowd, make it look like a parade. Let's infiltrate these groups. Let's lead these guys down the wrong path. And then as they're going there and they're coming into courts, we've got our plants, feed us all the information so our prosecutor is ready for every argument that they got. Now this is old history. This has been going on for thousands of years. It's happening today here in Canada. Some of the groups across Canada have been infiltrated. One of those guys, he's almost like a legend, some people have heard of him, is Tim Wishamon. He's from Edmonton. He came to the group about 1999. There was Gordon Schiller there, that group. It's been started by Eldon Warman and Fred Kybers out of Alberta. Alberta, which cool. They're kind of like the grandfathers of the freedom movement. Mm-hmm. And people have been coming and flocking to them for years. And this Tim Wishamon showed up one day. And Gord Schiller and I, one of these fellows that goes into court, and the judges are so scared of what he says, they jump up off the bench and run away. I've seen it twice with Gord Schiller. So Tim Wishamon shows up, and both of us had a kind of funny feeling about him. And then after about, oh, I don't know, 3 or 4 or 5 months of suspicions and rumors flying around, I had enough of that. I don't like that. So I put a paper down, and I said, it says on here, that you're swearing that you're not part of any type of organization for collecting information, not part of the government, the military, CSIS, NSI, a whole bunch of stuff that you're not part of, and you do swear that you're not any private investigation or anything like that. And so I put it around, there was about 10 of us or so at the table, I can't remember, 8 to 10. And everybody signed it except for two people. Tim Wishamon stood up, red-faced and embarrassed, and said, well, I guess I have to admit to you, I'm an undercover agent for the RCMP. And we're sitting there. Never in my wildest dreams did I expect him to admit it like that, but he did. Then another fellow stood up and said, I ain't signing this, got angry, threw the paper down on the table and left the room. His name was Vern Warwick. I know Vern. I email him all the time. I've asked him many times why he wouldn't sign that paper. He never told me. So what I advise, and the reason I'm telling you that, is I'm sure this information isn't going to end here, you're still going to be questing and searching in your lives, is if you get together with a group of people, and some of those people may be people you don't know from time to time, but you're detecting something suspicious, or you may have a fringe, feel no qualms whatsoever, any guilt whatsoever, any shame whatsoever, in drafting up a similar document like yourself, a disclaimer for everybody in the group, to save them harmless from any RCMP investigators sitting among them, is they ask you, sign here. You're declaring that you're not one of these guys. If they won't sign it, well, you kindly ask them to leave and we'll see you outside. You're not hurting anybody's feelings by asking that question. And if anything, you're saving grace for all of the people that are with you. Because if you are the subject of an implantation, you're going to be led astray and you're going to be fed false information. So it's good to know up front who's telling the truth and who's telling the lie. Now some of you may have also heard that there's people in this country that want you to invest your money offshore, and there's some guys in BC that have been doing this, and there's some guys here in Saskatchewan saying, well, hey, come on, we got a really good deal, you can't lose, and come and put your money in it, and they take your money and they're gone in the night. And you don't get none of it back. Well, some of these guys are still around. They didn't disappear. A lot of them have flown the coop to BC. They're living in BC. Some of these guys hurt people. They committed a crime against people, and they're out there not being punished. Well, that means that whoever got hurt by them didn't make a claim against them, didn't proceed against them, and by evident events, allowed it with permission. That's how it works. You can whine at the kitchen table for the next 20 years. You can know the guy's a crook and a thief, but if you don't take action, you submitted and you gave him permission to do it. It's hard sometimes to look in the mirror and realize that we submitted ourselves to things like that. But it's like if somebody comes and he says, I'm going to punch you. If you don't defend yourself, you're likely going to get punched. Because the best defense is don't be there as the fist is going by. You have to move out of the way. In the case of people that have come and already fleeced you, well, along with all these private notices that we're sending out, it's amazing what you can do with registered mail. If you have some facts that took place with any of these people that may have taken anything from you, doesn't matter what it was. Somebody could have stole something off your porch. If you know that they did it, and you're wondering how you're going to go about it, well, you can write them private notice mail. Tell them about it in private registered mail. If any of these facts are not true, please come back to me with evidence that you have that disproves the evidence I have. So you do it all at the court. There's the court right there. Registered mail. You get either an admission of guilt or you get a denial. And you get proof of innocence. All in a few letters. You don't need a judge. You don't need a court. You don't need a prosecutor. If this guy ripped you off and you put the message to him and he agrees, now you've got all this agreement, registered mail, and you've got proof. Now you've got something to take down to that guy, that prosecutor, because that prosecutor, even though he's a dead guy, he still has to save you harmless from harm. You've got proof of harm now. He come up, this guy, and he schmucked me. He stole money from you. Ain't no different. He hurt you. Now you get to use this, and you go to the prosecutor, and you say, hey, I've got evidence here. This guy admits it, that he hurt me. Here's the evidence. And you look at it, and you go, oh, wow, he does admit it. He didn't get back to you, and you gave him every opportunity to. Well, I'll have a look at this. Now he's going to contact that guy. That guy's got an opportunity now to shape up and try and recompense with you. He can say, oh, yeah, that was a misunderstanding. That money's going to him right now. Well, the prosecutor's got to let him pay you and then come back to you. Hey, you still want to go ahead with this? Now's your opportunity to do the brotherly thing and say, well, no, it was an error and he made a mistake. He sinned, but he's come and asked for forgiveness. He's paid me back, so no, I'm not proceeding. If he chooses not to come and pay you back after all of this, well, it looks like he's going to the Hoosco. If you've done your homework. Now, I make it sound easy. Words are easy coming out of a guy's mouth. It's another thing to sit down at your kitchen table with a piece of paper and start writing down the facts, because that means you got to use this. And we've been trained in society not to use this. We've been trained to expect the television to tell us how, the library to tell us how. Somebody else is always going to have to be there to tell us. We've been trained not to figure out how to do it ourselves. Well, that's sort of like a fact of society we're kind of stuck in. So then guys like me come around. And I know everybody here is fertile soil. Everybody here has a spark of faith. So I come along, I put the seed down on the table. I say, hey, you realize how easy this is once you know? All you got to do is put your faith down on a piece of paper, tell them what you believe in this, and ask them where they get the authority to intimidate you to leave this law. Send it off in the mail and ask them to reply if they do have any authority to intimidate you. But when they don't get back to you, you send them another letter. I say, well, thank you very much for your agreement. It's so good to hear that you have no authority to intimidate me to violate the word of God. It's registered mail. You got proof of that? You communicated back to them. You can keep this communication up forever. There's no need to stop. And there's no need to put a limit on how many people you tell. As a matter of fact, this book tells you once you take up the ministry of God, you're supposed to tell as many people as you can. But where did Jesus hang around? Was he singing to the choir? No, he was down there among the prostitutes and the wine bibbers. The prostitutes? Who are the main prostitutes of today's world? Not those girls hanging on the streets. It's our government lawyers, politicians, and bankers. Those are the prostitutes that we need to communicate to. We need to save them from their sin.
The whore of Babylon.
That's it.
That's what Murray says.
Huh? When you bring the queen into this, the queen is in honor. She's anointed of God.
And she's du jour.
Well,
kind of, sort of.
If you go to the fact that the oath that she took to God was as a private woman. Yeah, okay, I'll go for that. Because it doesn't matter what she says. You don't need no act of parliament for a woman to take an oath to God. Then that's the sure. But if you're going by that act of parliament, well, it was bogus. Because in 1689, they wrote the coronation oath and the words are the way they are. There was no amending formula. Other than parliament had to reconvene and everybody had to agree if they were going to change it. And it's never been
changed.
They've never, ever convened since 1689 to change the words in the coronation oath.
So it sticks.
1953 comes along. Well, remember what happened back in 1931? The king cut loose all the Commonwealth countries. Well, that was the first time that took place since 1689. Something changed. Now the king couldn't do what he said he would do in his oath. And neither could his successors after him, because he said he would protect the churches and the clergies in all of the Commonwealth.
Mm-hmm.
So after 1931, he cut loose the Commonwealth, so when the new queen, his daughter, came in after he died, she couldn't say, I'll protect the church and the clergies in all the lands. She said, with regards to the Church of England and the churches there, They added the word there instead of and the churches, which left it open for all of the Commonwealth. They added the word there. The Church of England and the churches there, which means only covering
England.
Yeah. And at the beginning where it says and protecting the laws of God, the Gospels, they added the word and. Laws of God and the Gospels. Now we have two separate things.
Well,
they divided.
They are separate. Law and Gospel is a division between Law and Gospel.
But what I'm getting at is they changed it. Okay, regardless of our opinions, and there's probably some good points that you
make.
But
you couldn't change it.
They couldn't change it, and they did. So the words that were said in 1953 were bogus as far as parliamentary law. But as far as a private woman, who she was, taking an oath to God, she can say whatever she wants. And it's still, well, as long as it's not obscene or anything. But I mean, she says she's going to do something to God. She can say that. She doesn't need no act of parliament to take an oath to God. So I'm saying her oath is valid. She took an oath to God. She said she'd defend the laws of the God. Of the God. To say, and the church is there in England, was a bit of an oxymoron. On one side of her mouth, she's saying, yeah, I'll defend the laws of the God, but only here. It doesn't work that way. If you're defending the laws of God, it's all of humanity.
Or all the Commonwealth.
All of
sure.
The Commonwealth, absolutely. She's the queen of the Commonwealth. You can't wear two faces, you know. I had a lieutenant from the JAG, Judge Advocate General for the military. I phoned him up and I was asking him about his oath of allegiance. And I said, you've taken an oath to a Christian monarch. He says, no, I haven't. And I says, well, who do you think you've taken an oath to? Well, I've taken an oath to that part of Her Majesty that's Queen of Canada. And I said, sir, where is your bloody sword? He said, what are you talking about? And I said, you just severed Her Majesty in half. Where did you get the authority to do that? Well, what do you mean? And I said, Her Majesty's the head of the Church of England. Is her primary duty and style is defender of the faith. You've just severed her down to Queen of Canada and taken away the defender of the faith. Where did you get the authority? Well, all of a sudden he's stumbling. He says, who did you want to speak to? Well, you know, he got gruff with me because I put him in a corner. It wasn't my intent to put him in a corner, but I was quite offended at the fact that he was saying that he only had to be allegiant to one part of the queen.
why do they keep saying in right of Canada or in right of province of Saskatchewan? They add those words.
Tell them a bait and switch. They want you to go running for all these fancy words. After all, you got to pay a lawyer $500 an hour. It's got to be real. No, it's just the opposite. It's fake. I'll give you one example. Most of you have heard that word person. Some of you have heard that the word person does not mean a man or a woman. And it certainly doesn't. It's a Latin word, persona. And it relates to an old Greek word, persona. We used to put a big paper mache or wooden mask over their head and it had a hole. We used to project the sound. Persona means with sound. It doesn't mean a man. It means a mask worn by a player on a stage.
So it's just an entity, not naturally.
It's not living, it's not breathing.
Not necessarily living,
it's
flesh
an instrument.
And blood.
It's an instrument, is what it is. A persona is an instrument.
So you never want to claim to be a person or a natural person.
What you need to do, that's right. There's a group around Canada, I believe it's called Paradigm Group. Russ Perisky and a few other people, Michael Spencer, have spent an inordinate amount of time and energy teaching people that they can declare themselves as natural persons because the Income Tax Act does not cover natural persons. And I thought, first of all, we have the word person. We've already established it's a mask worn by a player on a stage. So let me see. We put the word natural in front of a mask worn by a player on a stage, and we have a natural mask worn by a player on a stage. I guess that must be kind of like it's tree bark, okay? And you put it around your head, and it's got a hole in it. So that's a natural mask. And we know an artificial person, that must be, it's a plastic mask, okay? So then we got to ask ourselves, well, am I a mask? Whether it's plastic or wood, am I a mask? Second answer is, well, your answer should be no, I'm not a mask. If you're not a mask, you can't be a natural person. It doesn't matter whether it's natural person or person, that person word is still there. There are some people that figured, oh, great, we don't have to pay taxes if we're a natural person, and they line up. There's quite a number of them across Canada now. And Russ Perisky advertised on his website $5,000 to anybody that could prove that this was not true. And that you were completely immune if you were a natural person. So I took Russ Perisky, the World, or not the World Bank, but the International Court of Rome. I don't know, I probably won't be able to find it right here. I'll just keep talking. The International Court of Rome has up on its website the law that they passed that covers that international court. Here it is right here. Section 25. Of the International Criminal Court, the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court, says general principles of criminal law, Article 25, individual criminal responsibility. The court shall have jurisdiction over natural persons pursuant to this statute. So here we have evidence of a bait and switch where you're being told in Canada it's not really subject to this international court yet, telling us that these natural person things, if you're an income tax evader, is the best thing since sliced bread. So a lot of people are following this, and the income tax guys are keeping mum. They're letting this slide. And I'm suspicious. I'm wondering how come they're letting them get away with this. Because I've seen David Lindsay go to court, and this natural person thing got knocked out of the water by a judge in court. He made a precedent. Natural person in person, man, I don't care. It's you. And he made the decision knocking this stuff out of the water. By the way, David Lindsay also went to Russ Perisky with this court decision and said, you're wrong, here's proof. Russ refused to pay. So I'm wondering what's going on. How come he's still teaching this? How come a bunch of the Revenue Canada guys are going and not saying nothing about this natural person, and people are lining up? Then I discover this. Then I find out in about 5 years, Canada is not going to have that queen in the court system. It's going to be under the international court. We're going for a world government. One world government, one world court, and all those people that were lined up over there with natural persons stenciled and tattooed across their foreheads, because they put it there.
Now they're falling under.
They They got them. They submitted themselves to the international court before it even started. This is a lineup. This is layaway plan. The layaway plan for all those guys that wanted to wiggle out of taxation. Okay, we'll just set you over there for a while.
Parade.
Good plan. So I tried again. I phoned up Russ again and emailed him again to try and get him to stop doing this.
But he won't.
He won't. Question mark. Well, there's only two motives where people would keep promoting a falsehood. One, they don't give a damn and they want the money. Or two, they're getting paid.
Or both.
Either one doesn't paint them in a very good light. So this is why I say there are people crossing this country and they're charging people money to get out of the system and show them the surefire methods of doing stuff. If they're not talking about this, show them to the door. If they're asking you for money for videos and tapes and literature, show them to the door. Because they're conning you. There's no other way out of this mess of Talmud other than Torah. Torah is the first five books of this Bible. Now I come to the point that it's one thing to notify all the private guys in the government here. That's really good. It's another thing to notify the Governor General and the Queen and the World Bank. That's really good. Better thing yet, and I said last time I came here, and it's going to take place, is you notify the rabbis. The rabbis rule Talmud. If we want the grace of God's law, we have to go to God's people. Whatever we think about them, the rumors around the world, the history, it don't matter. They're in charge of Talmud. You want to follow the money, you want to change the problem, solve the problem, you've got to go to the top. So eventually, what I'm saying, after you display your faith, the private notices, etc., while you're doing this, or eventually while you're doing this, start planning, making the inquiries about how you get in front of a rabbi. Tell the story. How you get in front of a group of rabbis. Tell the story. Ask them, what is it that I'm doing wrong that I could be enslaved under a false law? How is it that I can get the rabbis to help me with this? Will you guys stand up for me? Will you join up? Will you help me to follow God's law? Well, you go to a rabbi and you ask him for help. He can't turn you away. And guess what? What better place to go than to find out about what's going on? If they're ruling this, but they also follow this, well, these guys know more than anybody. Because most of us out there are having a hard enough time following this, and we're totally lost when it comes to this. Because every time we go there, we lose. Every time you go here, though, you win.
So the group of rabbis agrees with you and they give you an exemption certificate so you don't have to pay taxes anymore?
Well, that's a theory. Something like that, what Rolf just said, is when you go to them and you're getting their help, they might write a letter or two to the Minister of Taxation and say, hey, yeah, this dumb Goyim, he woke up. Give him credit and stop harassing him. Otherwise, we'll be down.
Give him
a
$7 million back.
Yeah. Well, I didn't even get to that point yet. There's so much detail. Oh, thank you, Rolf. In order to make this debt money system work after 1933, when they foreclosed, remember they didn't get the king's jewels, but they got all that gold. Every country that had gold in its bank that went bankrupt lost all their gold. It might have still been sitting there, but they didn't own it anymore. It transferred over to the creditor, the banker who had been loaning exchange money the whole time. In other words, there was never a loan that took place. They come along and put down a document, the people signed it, created the funds right there in the office, and the guys that said, we're loaning you money, never told them that they created the funds right there in the office. They took the funds and they went and exchanged them for some other form of currency and then gave them back this currency. In other words, if you go in to tell somebody, I want a loan, and he reaches into his pocket and he pulls out a 20 and say, how much do you want? Oh, 20 bucks. Oh, okay. And he gives you the 20 bucks. You pay me back on Thursday. You got a witness there. You got a verbal contract. Everything's fine. That's a loan.
So banks don't loan other people's
money. Banks don't loan money at all. They don't loan anybody's money. They perform exchanges. They're nothing but a broker. You come in, you sign the piece of paper, there's a dollar value on the paper. So once your pen leaves the paper, that's known, as the banker will tell you, a negotiable instrument. If you ask the banker, is this funds? He'll go, yeah. Is it worth $100,000 like it says here? He'll go, yeah. So this is $100,000 worth of funds that you just signed. You haven't got your loan yet, but you got $100,000 worth of funds in your hand. He'll go, yeah. Here, you want to give that to me? You go, oh, yeah, I need to get the loan. So you give him the funds, and then he go opens up an account in the bank's name, and he writes down $100,000 in the account ledger, deposited into the bank's account. Now the bank's got $100,000 worth of funds that you just gave them. But law says, the Bank Act says they have to take your mortgage document, your instrument, your negotiable instrument, send it up the hill to the Bank of Canada, and the Bank of Canada then performs an exchange. They go to the general account, the revenue fund, the General Consolidated Revenue Fund, and there they look you up, and there you are, and they got a number beside your name, and that number's got an account, and they look in the account, and there's your value. You were bonded at birth for $8 million. If you're 50 years old or so, you're worth about $5.7 million. That's without the 12.7% a year interest that they tack on. So anyway, then they say, okay, this guy's worth 5.7 or whatever, he wants to do this exchange. They take off $100,000 off of the value that's listed there. Right? That goes on the debit side, but then they balance it out because then they put your negotiable instrument and it's registered in on the account as a credit. So it balances the books. Your negotiable, you signed that negotiable instrument, $100,000, that's funds. It goes in there. They extract off the other side the funds that comes out of their pile of currency that they're printing there at a penny a note. They send that currency, those funds, also known as negotiable instruments, down the hill to the bank. You go to the bank and say, I want my money, and they send you this Canadian money over the countertop. That was your money before you got it from the bank. It was your money when you signed the document.
You created
the money. The banker didn't loan you anything. He performed an exchange service. And if you look in the dictionary, under the definition for loan, it's like I said, you must be in possession of what you are loaning before you loan it. You absolutely cannot loan something you do not have. Whereas in an exchange takes place, is there's equal value for equal value. You gave the banker $100,000 in funds, he gave you back $100,000 in funds. The only difference is the banker says, I want you to pay interest. Now, if it was his funds, it would seem not too bad, still a violation of God's law, but it's not his funds. And he lied to you. He committed a fraud, and now he's expecting you to pay. He's extorting money out of you. Because he advertised in the front of his bank, loan, because it wasn't actually an exchange, that's called, because it was involving money, that's called fraud. I've had bankers sit right in your office, and I said, is this a thing I'm signing here? Is that a negotiable instrument? And they go, yeah. So when I finish signing this, is that worth the funds that it says here? And they go, yeah. So then who funded the loan? Well, we're funding the loan. I said, well, didn't you just say this was funds? Well, yeah. Well, then when I signed it and I created the funds, who created the funds? Well, all of a sudden the banker stopped. And I've had them do this. They just get stumped. They get red-faced. They don't know what to tell you because you got them in the trap now. They just admitted it's funds. You created it, and they're telling you that they funded the loan. They're lying. So bankers been at this for years.
How can a bank,
they don't know.
How can a bank not lie if it gets to court and you didn't pay your loan back? They say, well, we're out this much money. They say that.
Yeah.
They're lying. How
they're
can
lying.
They not be lying?
Sure they're
how
lying.
How can they have a loss?
But here's the problem with some of the bankers, and we got to feel sorry for some of these guys if we're to practice the principle of love your brother. If they've been deceived, we got to enlighten them and wake them up. A lot of bankers don't know that that's fraud. There was a bank case down in 1967 in Credit River, Minnesota. And there was a guy named Daly, and he had been pressed by the bank to pay his mortgage, and he found out it was all fraud, and so he said, I ain't paying no more. And the bank foreclosed upon him. He's got the book there. The bank foreclosed upon him, and We went to court, and they convened court in the county store, and they had the jurors there from around the people who lived in the area, and the judge and the banker showed up, and there's Mr. Daly, and he gets the banker up on the stand, and he asked them, who created the money? How did the money come about? And the banker admitted on the stand that he created the money by making an entry in the ledger. And so he said, so you then made the money right there by making that ink entry into the ledger. That was how you made the money. The banker said, well, yeah. So you just created the money out of thin air. And he says, well, that's how it's done. And the judge said, just a minute. You've just admitted here in front of the jury and on testimony that you created that money out of thin air. That's fraud, sir. You can't be telling these people you have money to lend them when you had nothing to begin with. You've just admitted on the record that you just committed fraud. You've entered it into the book there and you had no value behind it. You just made pen strokes and there's no money there other than your good word. Sir, that's fraud. You've admitted the record. Case dismissed, aside for the defendant. Well, the banker's flabbergasted. What just happened? And he admitted that the Federal Reserve did that too. So the judge also said, well, then the Federal Reserve is fraud. So then the bank went to appeal and it put down the required price for the appeal, two Federal Reserve notes. Guess who's on the other side accepting the money? The judge, because they do, in the small towns back then, they are clerks, judge, and they do multiple jobs. And he says, you've admitted on the record these Federal Reserve notes are formed in fraud. I can't accept those. Appeal dismissed. So it never did get appealed. It was still on the books as proof of the fraud.
So how did they get to charge us with fraud for whatever things we might do?
Because we did something wrong.
Ignorance of the law is no excuse. It sits in the courts, and if we don't take the law and use it to our benefit, it's assumed that we have given up God's law, we don't respect it, and we are to be enslaved. So now we got the choice, and that's why I'm here, to make you all aware. You've got a choice. In Deuteronomy, God says, I put before you life and death. Choose. This is dead law. This is living law. If you don't make them aware of which law you're choosing and why you're choosing it, they will assume that you're in this law. That's what they do 100% of the time. If you don't let them know unequivocally by registered mail, bringing the queen into it, that you're in this law, they assume you're in this law. And they got you enslaved, shackled, handcuffed for the rest of your life.
So if you're going to argue that law in court, you're going to lose.
Absolutely.
If you're defending fraud in that law, you're going to lose.
Every time.
Hey, let me read this paragraph really quickly. This is when you have the banker on the stand.
Okay.
In your opinion, what value does a check have if one cannot receive cash for it? They must answer, it has no value without cash behind it, proving the alleged money the bank has loaned us has no value without the promissory note giving it value, providing they loaned us nothing of value, proving they loaned us nothing of value to obtain the promissory note. It proves we handed the bank $100,000 actual cash value and they returned an equal amount of actual cash value back to us, falsely claiming they loaned us their money when it was merely a return of our own money.
That's it. Exactly. They return your own money to
you. What page are they on?
Okay, there's another thing that maybe I can't
page 239.
Going through it, but back when they knocked on the king's door and they said, you want your jewels?
Yep.
Okay, the king set the commonwealth free. So
yep.
Then where is the connection?
Oh, on 2/3 of the way.
The queen is still supporting us
back.
And helping us.
Because her name is still used in the Commonwealth. Her symbols are still used in the Commonwealth. It's all in Her Majesty's name still. Okay.
What are you making a cake?
The offer is there for as long as she is on the throne or she announces her abdication. I have no indication in my heart that she has any intention whatsoever of abdicating. As far as her health is concerned, her mother lived to what? 102?
So let's take a break.
So we got a few years.
Eh? Break?
Yeah, let's take a break.
Let's take a break.
Just hold on. Shut this off here.
Yeah. Shut that off.
Okay, we're going to continue now, if Robin's finished eating, after lunch break, the question or the issues being raised on the licensed preachers, preaching from the licensed churches, on, I guess, what's commonly used is Romans 13, paying the taxes. So he's going to have some explanation. Go ahead.
Probably the most commonly misconceived notion in the Bible is that Jesus compelled his followers to pay the tax to Caesar. There are probably well over 75% of the Christian denominations in the world that have this preached from the pulpit in conjunction with Romans 13 encouraging the people to submit to the false authorities.
So, I'm going to turn it off.
Those authorities...
That guy with the maple syrup.
In Romans 13,
where
is he? Are put there by God. And if we don't read Romans 13, we're never going to find out that it says they are ministers of God to thee for good. If they're ministers of God, and those are who we are to obey, then before we submit to people that are dressed in suits with red roses, we're supposed to ask if they are ministers of God and respect and honor God's law. If we don't ask, we submit ourselves to the potential of contracting and submitting to an imposter, a liar, fraud. When in Luke, I think it's chapter 22, where the tax collectors come and they mention to Peter, Peter's outside, Simon Peter, and they say, does your master pay the tax? Peter said, well, yes. And so he goes inside and tells Christ, the tax collectors are here, Master. I've told them you pay the tax. And Christ says to him, Simon, he calls him his first name because he figures he must be senseless. He hasn't caught on. So now he's lowered him down to the name that he was when he met him before he gave him the name of Peter. He says, Simon, what's the matter with you? He says, does the king pay the tax? Simon says, no. Well, does the king's son pay the tax? Simon says, well, no. Well, then I don't pay the tax either. I'm the king's son. But now that you've told them that we pay the tax, we don't wish to offend them. Go to the ocean and catch a fish and draw a coin out of his mouth and go give it to the tax collectors for me and you. Now,
in other words, go fix your screw up.
Well, yeah. Just a second. Yeah, okay. What's essential to note is what kind of a coin that he drew out of that fish's mouth.
It was too merry, though, was it not?
Well, if you go to the original scriptures, what you find is it's listed as a stator, which is a Greek term for a type of money. It just so happens that the Greek term for shekel is stator. So what was taken out of that fish's mouth was a shekel, one shekel. Does anybody here know what the Hebrew temple tax per man was per year?
Half a shekel.
How many men was Peter paying the tax for?
Two.
Half and a half equals one shekel. What tax did the Hebrew temple require? The shekel. What tax was he paying? The Hebrew temple tax. He never paid tax to Caesar, as he would have been violating God's first command, don't bow down to false gods, neither shalt thou serve them. Caesar had already said, I'm God, worship me. When Christ was approached by the Pharisees and say, Master, is it lawful for us to pay Caesar or not? Thank you. That's sugar. Is it lawful for us to pay Caesar? And Christ said, bring me a tribute coin. And he said, whose picture's on the coin? And they said, Caesar's. And he said, therefore, rend under Caesar that which is Caesar's, and rend under God that which is God's. He was doing pretty much the same thing that we have today in the courts when we have two forms of law, because back then there were two forms of law, and there were two forms of money. There was God's money with his name written on it, the Hebrew temple shekel, and there was Caesar's money, the man God, with his picture on it. So when Christ said, rend under Caesar that which is Caesar's and under God that which is God's, he gave everybody a choice. If you want to be under the laws of Caesar, under the laws of man, if you wish to submit to false gods, you're going to be using Caesar's money. If you wish to worship God's laws and bow only to God, you'll only use God's money. This is why, if you remember, Caesar threw the money changers out of the temple. Those people were exchanging shekels for denarius and other forms of money, but they were charging an exorbitant rate for the exchange. The fact that they were involving themselves with Caesar's money in the temple was an abomination to God and Jesus after warning them. He warned them, and they kept doing it. He lost his temper and he acted just like his father did in the Old Testament when he wanted to destroy him. He beat them soundly, kicked them out of there.
Maybe I'll run home.
Fouling God's temper with this false God's money, Caesar's money. So we get a choice. Even today, the same choice is there as there was with Caesar's money. We get the choice when we go into the courts whether we're going to follow God's law or we're going to follow Caesar's law. And with regards to that money, it's still Caesar's money. We're stuck using it. So when you go, I forget how much money I had, $20,000 in the bank. I took all of that money out of the bank over a period of time. Every time I took the money out of the bank, I wrote over top of my signature under threat, duress, and intimidation. So any contractual agreement that I may have had with the bank with just my signature has been voided. In other words, I'm not in consent to this system anymore. So what I'm suggesting is that there are some people that may wish to extract themselves out of the system. They have the opportunity, once they know that money is fraud, to say, well, you mean we need our own money? I'm saying, yeah, we do. Just like Canadian Tire. They make their own money, and the people that go to Canadian Tire get to use it there. When you form a church and you get a group of people together, you say, well, how can we make money? Say, well, it usually takes equity. People have equity in one form or another. If you take all your equity, everything you own, your socks, your toothbrush, your false teeth, and donate them to the church, now the church owns them, but the church says, we need a trustee. You know best about this stuff more than anybody, including all that money. We want you to be the trustee 100%. We can't do anything without you telling us what to do. As a matter of fact, we want you to be in total control with that money. Every time you buy something, it's for the benefit of the ministry. Make sure you buy good food. We want you to have nice, clean clothes to benefit other people seeing you, so they'll be more inclined to come and join up. So now, guess what? You don't own anything anymore, but you're the trustee of it. And the bank, the church holds all this equity. All this equity that each one of you is trusting out of your own desire says, I'd like to take 10% of the equity of my donation here and put it into the tithing pool. Upon your own voluntary, you put it in the tithing pool. Once it's in the tithing pool, it's equity for the whole of the church, and we can make money from that equity. It's like having gold in the vault. The land's as good as the gold.
Sure.
You can make the money. You can start writing your draft notes. See, you give a draft note to people, the people send it back to the church sends it back to value.
You guys can
show. Only we're going to send it to them back in either silver certificates or gold certificates that are redeemable in gold or silver. Because with this equity pool, this tithing, we're not just going to sit there with it a bunch of land, we're going to do stuff with it. We're going to buy a bunch of seed, plant carrots, plant potatoes. We're going to maybe invest in a mine, we're going to go get some gold. We're going to invest in something else, and we're going to build buildings. Once that equity pool, every year, people putting in 10%, as the Bible asks, it grows, you have a perfect capacity to run your own system.
Yeah, we raise tilapia.
Raise tilapia.
Yeah, and take the awful water and go fish.
It sounds, it's just a dream. It's coming out of my mouth, but the potential is only that far away.
Well, yeah. Tell us, if it's closer than a dream, of how we can access the balance of our bond.
Very good topic.
Show me the money.
Just to start at the beginning here, because 1933, there's no gold in the banks. Banks had foreclosed, taken it all, we're in receivership. Had to get something to balance the money that's floating around there to give it some value. So they took every man, woman, and child who was voluntarily offered by the parent to the doctor, from the doctor to the registrar, those banks were then formed in corporations, all capital names, and they were bonded to the tune of $8 million for each particular man and woman in the country. If ever you've been on social services, in the criminal justice system, in the healthcare system, and you couldn't pay, it came off your bond. If you've never ever had anything to do with that whatsoever, and you've paid your taxes all your life, your bond is accruing at 12.7% a year. You don't know about it, you're not going to ask anything about it, but you're the beneficiary of that bond. Now, since the whole system is set up under fraud, and it's all offering you man's law, and there's a little hint of God's law sitting beside the judge, and it's a closed book, once you begin to be aware of Jubilee and the Queen's duty to respect and honor Jubilee, you make them aware that you're aware of the fraud that took place and you want to be extracted from this fraud. As in Jubilee, you want her to exercise her duty to defend your faith. You say, they're holding my value in there, and you show her the evidence of it since I was born, and they've been using me to finance their investment system in this country, whether it be for a war machine effort or making pesticides or whatever they're doing. I can't be part of it. They're false gods. I want out. Now the Queen is caught up with being bound by the Bible. And if you're requesting and petitioning her, as I did, this isn't conjecture. I did this. I got a response from the Queen. When you petition her in your biblical standard, she's put on notice that she has to either defend you and help you gain your bond back, as in Jubilee, or quite literally and technically, she has abdicated from the throne. She has defied her duty to defend the faith. Now, I'm just one guy. I don't happen to believe the Queen is a bad woman, regardless of all the stories that we've seen in the media and the vilification that's taken part. I don't believe it. I believe that she's a good woman, and I believe that there's a lot of dark energy out around the world that wants to get rid of her and smear her and paint her in a bad light so she won't be as popular. That's just my opinion. I can't prove
that. She'd be very unpopular if she helped you or any of us get our bond back. I think she'd be the...
She would not be unpopular if she was following the rabbinical law. If you're questing after the Queen, it's important to note that the Queen is genetically of a heritage of the House of Judah. She is of Hebrew heritage. She is Jewish. She is bound by the law that if you're coming forth and you're saying, I'm practicing God's law, they're trying to enslave me with man's law. This is if I'm Goyim and I'm not following God's law. As a sojourner in Torah, I am also covered under God's law. As a sojourner in Numbers 15 and 15, I am covered under God's law. I accept no other authority. I do not accept the authority of man's law. And I'm asking you to convince these people here that they have no authority to intimidate me to violate my faith and beliefs. You are my defender of the faith. Do you intend to defend me? I wrote that to her. She wrote to the Privy Council, sent him a letter saying, I'm not amused. What are you going to do about this? The guy's got me on the ropes. You better fix this up. You can't spoil my royal style here. So the Treasury Board the Privy Council contacted the Treasury Board because they pay all the bills. They pay the revenue guys to intimidate you to violate your faith and beliefs if you've got them, if you know what I'm telling you. And then you begin to understand this and believe this. You go, wow, it is a violation of God's law. I can't pay them. So they don't have any authority to intimidate you to violate God's law. But once you bring the Queen on this and you're talking about your bond, listed there with the treasurer, and he's there and he's put on notice, but he's been put on notice in his private capacity. This is all a private matter. You take their lawyers right out of the picture. They can't go to their lawyers for defense anymore because you notify them privately about a religious matter. When they go to their lawyers who work for the government, I'm talking government lawyers, the government lawyer says, I can't help you. It's a private matter. The guy said right there to the private man. He's not talking to you as the prime minister, the premier, or the minister of revenue. He's talking to the private man. Go home. You're going to have to hire your own private lawyer.
What happens when he hires his own lawyer?
then right away, that lawyer has to pass the competency test. Wow. You're an ecclesiastic, you're a minister of God, you're a follower of Christ's dictates. Most certainly, you're not going to allow one of those lawyers that Christ told you about was an imposter.
To represent the opposition.
Yeah, so you're going to say, well, okay, I'm not going to call you one of Satan's broods yet. But first of all, tell me you understand your oath of allegiance to the Christian monarch that's sworn as defender of the faith. What's that oath mean? If you don't know it's to defend these laws, then you're an imposter. And I can't allow you to go to court, and I'm putting the judge on notice that when I come there, I'm going to be asking him what the meaning of his oath is.
Just read that into the record. That is a response from a lawyer.
This is a response that Stuart got back here from Dean Sinclair, the senior Crown Prosecutor for the province of Saskatchewan. He says, "Dear Sir, thank you for the letter of March 18th advising me that you are now a minister of a church." We got admission here, but it's a dead guy talking. "I understand you sent Mr. Wyatt a similar notification. Perhaps I am mistaken, but I got the impression from your letter that you believe you are not obliged to follow municipal, provincial, and federal laws because you are a minister. If that is what you meant to say, then I must respectfully disagree. I suggest that you should consult with legal counsel to obtain advice on this issue. Once again, thank you for informing us of your new position." And first of all, this sounds pretty good. We have a guy admitting that he knows he's a minister. The Bible's involved. He's on the hook. Sounds good until you see who he sent it to. Looks like he sent it to Stuart Lease here, 13 Lawrence Road in Kamsack, Saskatchewan. But there's a postal code there. Most people don't think anything of that. You phone up the Minister of Canada Post and you ask him, "What's that postal code mean?" And they'll say, "Well, that's an enactment that was drafted for commercial activity." And I said, "You mean if you use a postal code, you're in commercial activity?" And he says, "Yeah, it's assumed you're commercial if you use a postal code." I said, "Thank you very much. Goodbye." You don't have to use a postal code. When he sends this to Stuart, Stuart picks it up with the postal code on it. Stuart's accepting commercial liability. He says, "I'm in commerce. I'm following man's law. I'm one of those dumb goyim." Then we look down here, and who sent it to him? The Public Prosecutions Division, Saskatchewan government, the senior Crown Prosecutor. The man, Dean Sinclair, never sent this to him.
Well, he signed it.
The man did not sign this. The legal fiction, the dead guy signed this. The dead guy is the senior Crown Prosecutor hiding behind the corporation of the government of Saskatchewan. You can't hold him accountable for anything that he does. But you can hold W. Dean Sinclair, the private man, accountable if he intimidates you to violate your faith and beliefs.
So was this another offer?
Yes.
Was this a trap?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Was this bait?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. He's testing you. He's trying to get me to join an argument.
Back into the commercial side.
He got you because you accepted it.
He wants you to go to a lawyer. So you're going to fold this back up, put it back in the envelope, put opened in error, return to sender, put it inside another envelope with a little note on there that I'm sorry you've sent this in error. This is a legal fiction. I use no commercial postal codes. If you wish to communicate to my ministry, please address it to my name as following. You put your name and your address there.
It was on the notice that was sent.
But you're going to do it again, though, okay? This time you get some witnesses to put them on the sign that he's aware you're not commercial activity. You don't use a postal code. You might also want to put a little thing in there telling them about how you formed your name. We're literally without limit as to what we can say and educate these people to. If you don't like them messing around with your name, and you feel that that's a pretty important issue, whoops, then you ought to tell them. This is just a sample, okay? This says, lawful acceptable service notice. This is the good faith notice of acceptable form of lawful service upon the man born and with the Christian appellation of Donald Christopher Carter. This is the fellow in BC that sent the 13 pager to the tax man, and he's never heard from them since. Thank you, Dan. It says, absolutely no other formations or renderings of my name in a commercial or otherwise legal fiction corporate style will be accepted as they are formed in fraud, as I have offered no man nor woman nor fiction permission to alter my name for a commercial purpose. All such unlawful attempts of service and communication, inclusive of additions of commercial postal codes, to my true name will be refused for cause. Do not use a postal code or title myself as Reverend. I minister the Word of God. My Christian faith and ministerial following in God's Word forbids associations with dead commercial legal fictions. Matthew 6:24. It says, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. So once they get this in the mail, okay, along with, you know, the false letter that they sent you that was open in error, and I see Turo there shaking his head, thinking, I got conned. Don't worry about it. We all skin our knees. After a while, you don't skin your knees anymore. You're up and you're running.
Did you remember to send one to Eaton?
To these people.
Justice Eaton. Remember his reaction? Yes. When you asked him what his oath was? I never had Eaton. A lot of them don't know the part. When you went in to get a signature, you said to him, do you have an oath of office? The Treasury Board of Canada did not know the law from 1646.
The Westminster Confession of Faith. They didn't know. They were shocked and amazed. I've had other lawyers. I pull it out and put it in front of them. They go, what's this? And I tell them, that's the enforced law from 1646 regarding your oath. They go, no way. I'm going, yeah, have a look. They start reading it, and they go, no way. They get really scared. I've seen a few of them go white when they read this. Because it says, an oath is an act of religious worship. That's how it starts out. A lot of these lawyers don't believe in God. And here they see about the law. It's never been changed. It's still enforced regarding your oath. And it says, an oath is an act of religious worship. And you're asking, do you believe in God? No. Well, then you made a false oath. How can you have an act of religious worship if you don't believe in God? Can't do it. So it's really emphatic to take and look up. Stuart's got a copy of it, and I'll send you all copies. If you send me your emails, or I get your email address, you'll get copies of this. You'll be begging me to stop sending you stuff. Because I've slowed down. I really have. But I'd send sometimes 4 or 5 emails a day to people's email boxes because that's what I do. I sit in front of the computer, I research, and I say, oh yeah, well, if I can read it, they can. I'm forgetting the fact that they're at work. They got kids, they got other activities in their lives, and they haven't got time to spend 4 hours every night reading my email. So what happens is this stuff stacks up in their email box. I've been to people's places, and I've been sending this stuff. They're, oh good, they're reading it, and they're learning. And there's emails going back 2 years, and they haven't even opened them. So there's lots and lots of complex stuff you can get into. All the details. I could go on here for 2 weeks and still tell you stuff I hadn't repeated. But the most important part of all is establish your faith in their eyes. Let them know. Registered mail, private party, just like Christ said. And then when, back to our bond issue here, because Stuart wished to know how to access that bond. Before I go deeper into how accessing, first of all, I should deal with our primary motivation here and how to make this work. Because the motivation of faith must come from love, and love is not the quest of money. So if your motivation for doing this to get your bond back is because you truly wish to be free of that corrupt system, and you know for sure that if you leave it there, you're still attached and enslaved to that false god government, well, that's an excellent motivation. If your motivation for going after the bond is just for the money, because you want the money, well then whatever you're doing isn't going to work for you. Even though it'll all make sense, you got all the law and all the facts there, it'll backfire on you, because there's an energy about doing things. If you're doing things for the motivation of good, and you know it's for good and for love and for freedom, whoa, there's wonderful power there, and it just keeps on getting better. But as soon as you're doing something just for yourself, for your own selfish measures, well, then you make a dark spot on you, and it seems to spread, and it'll even go over to others.
Well, just because you're after money doesn't mean you're after selfish efforts.
Well, it depends on what
money
you do.
Money is the second most used word in the Bible.
That's
right. After love.
That's right. So I just wanted to emphasize that the motive for going after the bond must be to free yourself from the corrupt system. That's the last attachment. If you don't go after it, you're still attached. They're using your name for a financial purpose without your permission. That's fraud. And if you're allowing the fraud to take place, you're part of the fraud. A man that follows the dictates of Christ can't have anything to do with the fraud.
What
so when
you
put it to the queen, I have to get out of this. Help me, please, tell the treasurer to release me. I've already had treasury say, you're right. Now what do?
Release
them. They've never done a redemption before. They don't know how to do it.
We got to show them how.
We have to show them how. I could have gone in there by myself and done it and done the hoodah, and I probably wouldn't be here today. I'd probably be 6 feet in the ground somewhere. I thought, no, they invited me. I said, no, I don't think so. I'll be back.
We'll come with 10.
So I come back, and now I'm coming out. I'm telling people. I keep talking. And Christ said, don't put your seeds in rocky soil. When you set the seeds of knowledge with people, you can tell whether they're rocky soil or fertile soil. And I'm telling you all, there might be some rocky soil here. There might be some fertile soil. I don't know all of you. But what is going to happen is if you take the seed of knowledge and you decide to put your faith to work, you're fertile soil. You're going to sprout out and grow and look out. God's wonder will come on you and you'll wake up to stuff and you won't even need me anymore. And I hope it's that way quicker. Because I don't want you to need me. I want you to need the Word of God. So you can go tell them. You can't bother me anymore. And then what I really want you to do is go tell others. Because that's what it's all about. Once you get it down, you got to go duplicate yourself. Tell other people. And increase the amount of freedom that's out there. Because everybody that knows sends that letter in. Okay? They're done. Once you put them on notice, and now we're a group, we're on numbers, they're keeping a file on our church down at the Treasury Board. Every time somebody calls that Treasury Board and mentions the church, oh, we got a file on you, and they put it in the file. The reason they're keeping a record is because the Queen's put them on notice. Don't fumble this ball. I am not amused. You keep a close tab on this, and don't embarrass anybody, okay?
Collection.
So it's also important that if you want to go after that...
Not on camera.
If
you want to go after that...
It's a motivating force.
Speaking of bond on camera, we're talking about passing the hat here. It's just getting some gas money to get back to British Columbia.
Yeah,
so I can come back here again at the end of the month.
Yeah, that'll work.
But at any rate, if you want to go after that bond, I'm saying it's accessible. But I'm saying now the very most primary thing, first of all, to focus on is to get your faith and beliefs on paper as only you know how. I can give you samples. Stuart can help you with some samples that he's utilized, but I strongly encourage people to take the words that you see me write. Let your heart spill out of its chest onto the page. Put some of your words there too, okay? And now it's yours. You own it. I can do it for you, sure. You just put your name to it, but it doesn't have the same power. If you put your heart's words on that page, it'll wrap itself around you, and anybody that gets it, now you're protected, you're immune, you have God's shield around you, because you put your faith into it. If you use just my words, it's still going to work, but it doesn't have the power. The real power is exercising. I'm going to show you how to ride your bike. You can't just, you got to get on the bike and ride it. Once I show you how, you got to get on the bike and ride it. Once you start riding, you might fall off and skin your knees a couple of times. It's expected. But once you get your balance, you don't need the guy holding the seat anymore. You're on your own, and away you go. And it's just that simple. There isn't anything complex. There's no tricks. There's nothing waiting down the corridor. Somebody jumped up, ha ha, fooled you. You didn't know this one. No. There isn't. So you can get that bond. I'm working on mine by talking to you. The Treasury Board said to me, what do we
Secretary.
Do before I go back to exercise my bond? I have
Secretary.
Some witnesses that know what I'm saying, believe it, and are willing to stand up and say, I'm next. It's just like, the reason I'm coming back, I'm going up to Elida. There's a fellow up there at Elida, some of you know, Gavin Lemieux.
Thank you.
He says, let's deregister. Let's get one. And he says, you can't tell these farmers. You can yak and yak and yak. They don't listen to this anymore. They look for action. We show them some action and they'll be flocking all over us here.
Yeah.
I said, okay, well, we got to deregister. He says, good, let's start with me. We'll get that deregistered. I'll put it up in the town hall, and I'll invite everybody to come down and see it. Once they see it, there's the action. He did it. And then the buddies are lining up. Pretty soon, we got half of Saskatchewan.
Deregistering.
All deregistered.
All cars, all trucks. If they're not commercial. If they're taxi cabs or trucks or limousines, they have to have a license and a permit.
Not if they're owned by the church.
That's true. Not if they're owned by the church.
And then everybody gets in. You know, it's donation.
We'd be facing, no doubt, roadblocks wherever we go.
Only for a short
Christ
time.
Said that you will be persecuted if you take up my name. So you have to expect that. It's not like I'm insane inviting you to experience intimidation and pain, but I am warning you, trying to tell you how to experience less intimidation, less persecution, by being diligent, by telling them privately what nobody's ever done before. Yeah. Christ told us how 2,000 years ago, and as far as I know, nobody's been doing it.
That's right.
They completely ignored him.
Angels are crucified.
Right, right. He came to let us all know the way and the light. He said, I am the way, I am the light. And the only way to the Father is through him. So if you believe that, and you believe that he died for your sins and was raised from the dead, now is your chance to stand up for your faith. Prove it. Let them know. Say, my duty, I'm supposed to go and minister to people and tell them about God.
There's articles and articles of news that I've read in the past 2 months about these guys in the United States that are in the ministry, and there's some major observations that they've picked up. And one of the biggest things is that the men in most congregations are milquetoasts. They're wimps because they long for a battle, whether it's spiritual or real. And they're having their hands tied every time they get up and pray and sit down again. And they get up and they pray some more and they sit down. And it's sort of the women that are taking over as leadership in the churches because they have a different mindset than the men. The men want to fight. There's an urge to fight for something.
And then there's promise keepers.
Yeah, now who ties in with whom? I mean, are they following the Word of God, or are they following some New Age guru? Some new guy that came up with a concept, well, we should be doing this. Like, let's leave the blood out of the Bible. So we'll print a whole bunch of Bibles without the word blood in it, because it doesn't appeal to a lot of people. So what? What do you mean, appeal?
Look who's
Did
eating.
God appeal to Sodom and Gomorrah when he destroyed them for homosexuality? I don't think so.
Look who's leading Promise Keepers, none other than Dr. James Dobson himself, on hundreds of radio stations. So that's what we get to hear at 6:30 every evening.
Yeah.
That's about it.
What do you mean by Promise Keepers?
Well, you haven't listened to Dobson.
No.
It's the men. They pulled in the men.
They pulled the men finally.
Yeah, they pulled the men to keep the families together, and they're promising they'll hold to God's law and keep their families together and submit to the governments all the taxes they owe.
Because he's politically correct, he's on the radio, he's in broadcasting.
He's got everybody brainwashed into, you got to follow your president because he goes to the church and pay your taxes.
And so is Billy Graham, because these guys are public figures and they're on the
picture of Billy Graham kissing the ring of the Pope back in 1982 when he was in the Vatican. He was on his knees, Billy Graham, kissing the Pope's ring.
Now, I just want to shortly here give you all a reason why you don't ever want to go to court. This will give you prima facie evidence. This was a case, this first skinny transcript here, there was a lady in Stony Plain, Alberta, whom I know, and she was charged with failure to file. And she was very intimidated and very scared and didn't know how to speak for herself. And she asked me if I'd come to court.
What I would do is I would love to sit down with them and explain the difference between, like, once I learned more enough what I'm talking